Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Gino Wickman and Peter Economy here. Gino and Peter are both prolific writers, and they both have some new books out, so I'm really excited to talk to them. Gino's book is about taking the entrepreneurial leap, and Peter, well, he's got so many books. It's going to be interesting to see which one we're going to talk about. He's also known as the leadership guy at Inc. magazine. So between these two, it's going to be a very entertaining hour. So stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Gino Wickman, who is the author of Entrepreneurial Leap, which is devoted to helping entrepreneurs in the making understand their genetic makeup and give them a huge jumpstart, along with a clear, simple path to fully realize their potential. It's so nice to have you here, Gino.
Pleasure to be here, Diane.
Well, I was looking forward to this because I saw you have an obsession for learning. And since I'm a curiosity expert, I have to say I love that. I want to get a little background on you. What led to that obsession? What got you to this point of having this super successful book and all the stuff you're working on now?
You bet. And I'll touch on the obsession for learning pieces in the story, but and I'll try and give the fast version of the story. And if you want to back up and go deeper, we can certainly do that. But no, very quickly, I've been an entrepreneur since I was 21 years old, out of high school, graduating with a solid 2.3 GPA. I knew that academics were not for me. And as my friends all went off to college, I went to work. And I tried various things. I tried to get rich quick multiple ways up to my early 20s, and then found myself in the real estate industry because I was investing in real estate and had real estate agents putting commissions in their pockets. And I figured I'm getting my license. And during that process, I got involved in real estate, really understood what it is that my dad had done. And he had built the number one real estate sales training organization in North America. And so long story short, I applied all of his teaching. Was very successful in real estate. And then when I discovered what his company did, I fell in love with the company and decided I want to run that company. And so by 25, I had taken over running that business. I went from a six-figure income in real estate to making 25 grand a year selling his products door to door and just worked my way up through the business. Then discovered that the business was in need of a turnaround. I was able to turn the business around, got out of some deep, ugly debt, ran it for 7 years. We successfully sold it. During that experience, I got involved in the Young Entrepreneurs Organization and also the Strategic Coach Program, and just all of a sudden saw this need in the world for entrepreneurs and helping them run better businesses. And so the fanaticism about learning is all through my 20s. I was just an absolute student of business and entrepreneurship and what makes businesses work. And I had two amazing mentors in my dad and a gentleman by the name of Sam Cupp. And upon selling the business, transitioning in the new leadership team from Virginia, and then retiring from that business, I then set out to pursue what was truly my passion, and that was helping entrepreneurs get everything they want from their businesses. And so over about a 20-year period, I created a system called EOS, the Entrepreneurial Operating System. I've written 5 books around it. We built an organization called EOS Worldwide with 350 implementers all over the world, sold more than 1 million copies of those books, and then sold that business a couple of years ago to then pursue the next passion, which is what we're talking about, and that's Entrepreneurial Leap. And that's going back and teaching that 18-year-old person that I was, a lost, confused, mislabeled, derelict entrepreneur that I didn't know I was and what I was until really 29. And I want to help people know what they are much, much sooner and kind of pull these entrepreneurs in the making out from wherever they are. And so it, you know, could be in the corporate world, the inner city, could be in school, wherever they are. I want them to know what they are. This what I call the 4% of the world that possess these 6 essential traits. And that's the fastest version I can give you of the whole story.
Well, no, that was really interesting because I'm thinking you met Dan Sullivan, strategic coach, I imagine.
Yes.
I've met him at Joe Polish's network here in Arizona.
Oh, yeah, fantastic.
And I imagine you're part of that since
you
mentioned some things that make me think you might be.
Yes.
And it's very interesting to see some of the great things I've learned from a lot of people who I've met through that group of people, because they do a lot to help people with mentoring, and they have just a world-class group of people. You're talking about teaching your 18-year-old self kind of people, and I'm curious what you think about having them make some mistakes. If we help them, are we having them miss out on some important lessons?
Well, I don't think so, because the reality is they're still going to make mistakes. And so the way I describe it is this book is written in 3 parts: confirm, glimpse, and path. And when I describe path, what I'm doing in path is I'm showing that person who has confirmed that they're an entrepreneur in the making. They see a glimpse of their future and now they're going to move forward. What I'm saying is I can help them get a huge jump start on taking that leap. And I feel I can eliminate half the mistakes they're going to make, but they're still going to make the other half. It's all part of the learning process. You cannot avoid, you know, many of the mistakes you're going to make. They're just all part of the process. But some of them are just really silly and avoidable. And so I want to just create awarenesses so they avoid the easy, silly ones and then bump their heads a bunch of times with the stuff they're supposed to bump their heads with.
Well, I like the not having to reinvent the wheel thing. And I think there's so much of that going on that you just waste so much time. If somebody else has done it, just tell me that part. And I can use this bit and this part from this person. And I love that. And it's interesting that you have such a background in real estate, because I've had Tom Hopkins on the show. And I have a real estate license, but I really never did a lot in real estate. But I'm very interested in what you learn from all of that. I mean, any sales job is so helpful to anything you've done. Do you think everybody should have some kind of sales training?
Oh, there's no question. And Tom and my dad were good friends, so I'm aware of Tom. I knew him just a tiny bit, but what a great guy he is. And with that, absolutely. You know, especially if you have a listener that wants to become an entrepreneur, yes, it will greatly increase your odds of success to really learn and understand sales skills, and certainly in that vein, marketing. There's no question about that. It has served me very, very well.
Well, you mentioned, what did you say, 4% have 6 essential traits? I'm curious what those are.
Yeah, so the 6 essential traits are visionary, passionate, problem solver, driven, risk taker, and responsible.
I want to make sure I got all that. You said visionary, passionate, problem solver.
Driven.
Risk taker. Okay.
And responsible.
Okay. So I am an expert in curiosity, and that's what I've written about. So where does curiosity play in all of that?
Well, I think by nature, the combination of being visionary and driven makes you curious and makes you a learner. So, you know, what a visionary is, because it's an ambiguous term. And so this trait that is visionary, these are the idea people of the world. These are the people that are able to connect dots that most can't. They have a sixth sense. They see around corners. So they just have this ability to, like I said, connect the dots. And in that is that curiosity and that fanaticism for learning and wanting to understand. But again, it's always about what they're passionate about. It's not about everything. It's about this thing. They tend to go really deep into, you know, this thing that they're very passionate about and very driven to bring to the world.
You know, that's interesting as you say that, because I don't know if you've read the book Range, but his whole premise is that, you know, that sometimes we have tunnel vision, that, you know, the more range we have, the better. Do you think that you know, we need to be less tunnel vision sometimes and broaden our interests?
That's such a great question. You know, so it's, you know, so I'll try and answer this as briefly as I can, but there's kind of like three data points that flash into my mind on that. The short answer is it's a debatable topic, but you're going to hear what side I fall on this debate, you know? So the first is, you know, what I'm teaching my clients, you know, we have almost 100,000 companies that run on EOS all around the world. And what we're teaching and what I've always taught is focus. And so what I have seen over time, my 30 years, my three decades of helping companies and building companies is focus. And so when I go to a client and work with a client and they've got six things that they're focused on, I try and get them down to one. And so I'll start with that basic premise. The second is, you know, Jim Collins' incredible work with Good to Great, talking about the hedgehog and the fox, and his research and his studying show that, you know, the hedgehog companies succeed far greater than the fox-like companies. And so the fox knows many things and the hedgehog knows one thing really well. And so, again, there's great that just your listener reading that chapter will shed some light on this topic.
Right.
And then maybe the third, now that I think about it, those are probably the most important two to tell you where I land on this, because, you know, jack of all trades and master of none, I just subscribe to that quote. And, you know, all I can do is speak from experience and how living that way has worked for me and what it's done for me and what it's done for our clients.
Well, do you surround yourself with other hedgehogs then?
Yes, that is exactly right. And so, you know, for all those other skill sets that are necessary, yes, you surround yourself with those skill sets, or you have a phone number for those skill sets. You know, I have a lot of phone numbers for things I need done. Uh-huh. So, you know, in a very simplistic example is, the way I look at it is, the more time I spend in my sweet spot, both learning my sweet spot and practicing my sweet spot, everybody wins. And like I said, then I have a phone number for everything else. So even on the home front, you know, to do the things around the house, I'm not a handy person at all. And so, you know, I have a phone number for the things that need to be done. And it's also silly for me to go spend a half a day on something I don't enjoy at all,
right,
and take away from either my family time or practicing my craft. It's a really bad formula. Again, unless you love cutting the lawn, you know, fixing outlets, electrical problems, whatever it is around the house. So hopefully that makes sense, at least my perspective.
Well, that ties into being passionate, right? You're passionate about this thing.
Exactly.
And are you saying, when you're talking about passionate being one of these six areas, or is it five? Six areas.
Six, yes.
How do you develop that passion? Is this something that comes naturally to people, or do you stumble upon it from other past experience? I'm curious where this comes from.
Yeah, this is another great topic. And by the way, this is an entire chapter of the book. So this is a topic that I'm very passionate about, no pun intended. And so I do think you ultimately discover it. And I think that it almost always stems from a wound of some sort. And so it typically stems from some sort of pain or experience in your life. And so it's, you know, just like the mother who has a one-year-old and invents the next best thing for a one-year-old because of something that they were struggling with raising their one-year-old. You know, there's hundreds of those stories. You know, my passion for business stems from me saving a family business and turning around a family business. And so, again, I believe that it stems from a wound and experience that you had. In addition to that, there are exercises you can do. And again, like I said, I wrote a chapter on it. I put a bunch of exercises, but I just want to share one with you and your audience, because I can share it in less than a minute. And it's really helpful. And it doesn't matter what age you are. And so it's a 30-minute exercise. You sit down with a journal or a legal pad or whatever it is you like to capture your notes in. But writing is very powerful, scientifically proven. So I urge you to write. But you answer three questions. And the first question you answer is, what are my three greatest successes? Second question you answer is, what are my three greatest failures? And then the third question you answer is, what has life prepared me for?
Hmm.
and out of that exercise, and I cannot remember where I learned that exercise, but I learned it about 15 years ago, and for me, it was transformative. And so again, everyone's going to have a different answer. Everyone's going to have their own journey with this, but it's exercises like that that help start to bring to light what you're really and truly passionate about, because it's a different answer for everyone.
Yeah, I love that you're asking questions, because of course that ties into curiosity. And I think curiosity ties into this problem solver aspect. What I found in my research, there were four things that keep people from being curious, and their fear, assumptions, that voice in our head, technology, over or under use of it, and environment, basically anybody we've ever come into contact with. So how do you think curiosity might tie into problem solving? Do we need to ask these questions to solve the problems? We need to be able to see things from other people's perspectives and develop empathy to solve the problems. I'm sure we need that right now in this time of crisis in the United States. What do you say about problem solving in when you talk about this in your book or write about it?
Right. So, and I'm gonna grab one last piece on that previous question and bring it right into this next question, because you know when I'm talking about passionate as one of the six essential traits, you know, it's truly a trait. And so with an entrepreneur, somebody that has these traits, you know, they're passionate about their thing, their product, their service. They have strong belief. They want to fill some kind of a void in the world. And so I just want to make sure that I make that final point, because, you know, it's your nature to be passionate about your thing. Finding your passion is a whole nother conversation. So I want to separate those two. And on this subject of the six essential traits, now you're taking us to problem solver. And so what's important here is I'm saying that this is an essential trait of an entrepreneur. And my belief is that these are traits. So these are not skills. You cannot learn these. They cannot be taught. You're born with them. You're genetically encoded. And in that, you and I could probably have a wonderful half-day debate. So, assuming that is true, what I'm saying here is a problem solver is someone that has always just leaned into problems. They're creative problem solvers. When they hit a setback in their life, they lean into it. They are optimists by nature. They see solutions where other people see problems. And so when you talk about, you know, these tough times, it's the perfect time, because the reality of what's happening is while everyone is running out of the fire, entrepreneurs are running into that fire right now. And it's a great, you know, I offer an assessment with this work and for your listener to decide, am I really a problem solver? This is a great opportunity to think about, how are you reacting to these times? You know, and then you'll know more about this than I will because of your, you know, your work, your knowledge. But, and I can't remember the two parts of the brain, but when these times are this scary, you know, people that are afraid, they spend their time in that survival fear-based part of the brain. Mm-hmm. And what you have to do is you have to shift to the part of your brain that goes into solution mode, that gets ready to fight. And so when you talk about this curiosity thing that you started with, you know, what I prescribe to every business owner is to take a clarity break. And so what I would urge for anyone listening, the way a clarity break, for me, I do it sitting in a Starbucks 2 hours a week. And it's thinking time, and it's so hard to do. It's a discipline, but just spending time, I always recommend, again, writing with a pen, with a journal, with a legal pad, but just sit and think and get that shift to occur in your brain. So as opposed to sitting there afraid and freaking out and running, lean into this thing and just spend some quiet time. You can also meditate. You know, the meditation has been great for me in these crazy times. I've had incredible ideas come to me. And then the other thing too is it's about talking to people. So the more you talk to people, the more you start to get ideas, the more you reach out to help people, your brain just starts to shift to solving problems, getting creative, having ideas. And so there's the best answer I have for you.
It's really interesting because as you're talking about traits, you know, when I study curiosity, there's a curiosity gene coined by the Max Planck Institute. And we all have this certain level that we peak about age 5 and then it decreases as we get older. And some of this was based, you know, a lot of the work I researched included mindset and all that. And I think that mindset might also tie into when you talk about being driven, how we decide if we want are open, you know, to learning more and doing more. I'd like to hear how you describe the driven part of what you wrote.
Yeah. And so driven, the way that shows up, and again, I always like to articulate this for your listener to kind of think about themselves and kind of do a checkup from the neck up and really get a sense of, is this me? But driven is you just always have had this internal fire, this sense of urgency, this competitive spirit. You want to succeed. You're self-motivated. You hustle. And so those are the words I like to describe when I'm trying to help somebody understand what I mean by driven.
And does that tie into being able to handle risk into the next of the six listings? I think risk is an interesting thing because to be really entrepreneurial, you have to leap. How do you develop that?
Yeah, well, this is a fun one because, you know, when you say develop, you know, as again, if you're hearing my philosophy,
right.
It can't be developed. So historically, if you have this trait, you've always been a bit rebellious, okay? And so the point here is, because this is a fun one, mm-hmm. because everyone thinks that when you take your entrepreneurial leap, that's the risk that you took. That's what makes you a risk taker. Mm-hmm. When in fact, that's only one of 1,000 risks right. you're gonna take over the next 10 years. Uh-huh. And so you are gonna be faced with 1,000 uh-huh. tough decisions, right? That can put you out of business tomorrow. And especially in these tough times, when you know you took the leap, you've taken the risk, you've started your business, you're 6 years into this thing, and all of a sudden you get your ass kicked, like what's happening to a lot of us right now. Well, that, you know, there you go. There's a risk because, you know, are you going to lay everybody off? Are you going to lay 20% off? Where are you going to cut expenses? How are you? So it's constant. Every single day you're making tough decisions. And that's why I always like to say, listen, I'm not saying entrepreneurship is this wonderful elitist thing that everybody needs to go become. It's not all it's cracked up to be. We're borderline crazy. And all I'm trying to do is I'm trying to help anyone that has these six essential traits understand this is why you're considered a little wacky, a little kooky, a little different. And so with risk taker, to kind of pin this down, what I like to say is this trait is where you just simply don't freeze. When you get faced with a tough decision, you make the decision. Again, you are rebellious by nature and you're willing to fail. You don't want to fail. You don't intend to fail. Lots of entrepreneurs have fear of failure, but you're willing to fail. You know, that's part of the journey. That you're willing to fail and pick yourself back up and keep trying. And so that's how I describe risk taker.
As I'm looking at these six these six traits, I really can relate to all of them, especially the next one being responsible. But for me, probably the one that I find the most painful would be the risk taker one, because I wouldn't say I would hesitate, but I would say it hurts a lot for me to lose. I'm super competitive. But the responsibility aspect, I mean, I'm super responsible, and I'm looking at these. Is there one of these six, I want to hear about responsible first, and then I want to know, is there one of these six that you can do without more than any of the others?
Oh, that is my favorite question. Okay. So I'll start there and then I'll answer the responsible question because the answer is no, it's all six of them. And again, I'm not making this up. This is 30 years of experience. This is a lot of interviews. This is validating this, making sure that these entrepreneurs in my life say, yes, that is me, them all taking the assessment. And so you have to have all six. Second part to your question is this responsible one. I always love explaining this one because it's the one that's kind of an oddball. And you're, you know, a lot of people think, what does that have to do with being an entrepreneur? And so first let me explain it. And so this responsible trait means that you default to blaming no one. Whenever something goes wrong, you look at yourself. You don't look at others. You blame yourself. You don't blame others. And the reason it's a trait and you're born with it and it can't be taught and it's nature over nurture is you picture a family with lots of kids. And we can all picture these people in our life. And for those of you listening, and maybe you, if you have siblings, you have siblings in two different camps. And so if you think about your siblings, half of those siblings, when something goes wrong, defaults to blaming everyone else, and the other half default to blaming themselves. They just look at themselves first. And the best way I've heard this described for people that have this default to taking responsibility is one of our ELS implementers, he shared, you know, the true definition of responsibility is if a meteor hits your building, your first default is, it's my fault.
And
that says it all, because, you know, I chose that location. I built that building. So if you understand that where you are in your life is a culmination of all of your decisions, it's your fault. And so, long story short, that's what we mean by responsible, and half the world takes responsibility. And just for the record, the people that don't take responsibility and the people that take too much responsibility, both are psychological disorders. I'm not saying either of these scenarios are healthy. I'm just saying what is. Exactly. An entrepreneur just tends to take responsibility and probably too much responsibility. But again, that's the reason they build all the things that get built in this world.
Well, I could see that a lot of people can really gain a lot of information from this book. I know you're, you know, the best-selling author of Traction. You've done so much in the past. And I think anybody that's listening and they want to know if they have what it takes to become an entrepreneur, they're going to want to read Entrepreneurial Leap. And if they want to get in touch with you, Gino, or get your book, is there some kind of link or something you'd like to share?
Yeah, for sure. Everything is at e-leap.com. And so that's the website. What they'll find there are 9 free tools, but a couple examples are they will find the Entrepreneur in the Making assessment, where they can take the assessment for free and get a good sense on whether they have these 6 essential traits. The first 30 pages of the book are there, so they can get a free chapter so they can get a sense of this content. And if it sucks them in, then they can go ahead and purchase the book along with, you know, other great free tools to help them ultimately decide, are they an entrepreneur in the making? Should they take their leap? And if they do, greatly increase their odds of becoming entrepreneurs.
Well, that's awesome. I know they can also subscribe to your Entrepreneurial Leap YouTube channel. You've got a lot of stuff out there. Read Leap at Twitter. There's so much that they could do to find you. It's been so much fun having you on the show, Gino. Thank you.
It is my pleasure.
We will be back right after this message. Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com. I am here with Peter Economy, who is the best-selling business author, ghostwriter, developmental editor, and publishing consultant with more than 100 books to his credit and more than 3 million copies sold. In addition, he's the leadership guy on Inc.com with more than 1,500 articles published to date, garnering more than 500,000 page views a month. His most recent book is Wait, I'm the Boss? I'm so excited to have you here, Peter. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Diane. Great to be here.
Oh, this is going to be fun. You know, I loved, you know, I always have everybody send me their bios and their information. And yours reminds me of like the most impressive CV on the planet.
I'm going
page 1, page 2, page of books you've written. This is not just, these are just the things you've been behind and articles and things that you've done. And I'm going, okay, books. Wow. How do you have time to write so much?
I just write almost all the time. I don't know. I guess I've got sort of a natural ability in this writing thing because, you know, I was a manager for many years. And when I was a manager, I didn't write much at all, you know, just reports, memos, things like that. But I didn't realize that I guess my natural, you know, calling was to be a writer. And once I figured that out, then I just started churning it out.
Those must have been some eloquent memos.
Oh, I don't know if my employees would have said that. They may not agree with you.
Well, you really have an impressive list of things you've written, and it's all very, you know, high level, you know, business information. I mean, there's just so much great content in this. And I know you've got a most recent book, as I mentioned, and I want to talk about that. But I just, you mentioned a little bit about your background. Could I get just a little bit more, just what led you to this point?
Sure. So I was a manager for probably about 10 years. And I worked up into that position and really had never been trained in management, which is sort of part of the motivation of why I wrote this book in the first place. But, you know, I was okay. I think I was an okay manager, but I wasn't a great manager by any means. And I think that really came to the fore when I was assigned all of a sudden a group of 500 people. And when I was assigned to lead five, yeah, that's what I, in retrospect, it was like, wow. But back then I was like, oh, wow, you know, this is great. I'm going to get paid more. I'm going to have this great title, VP, you know, vice president of the, whatever it was, this or that. And, but in retrospect, I really didn't know what I was doing. I didn't have any training in being a manager. I mean, I'd gone from maybe managing 10 people all of a sudden to 500 people. And it's a big difference. I
Oh,
mean,
yeah.
that's a huge difference. And so I think, although I hobbled through, I think I wasn't that great. I think I was kind of a failure when it came to management. So anyway, somewhere along the line, one of my friends said, "Hey, would you want to write a book?" He was an editor with Scott Forsman, which was a big publisher at the time. And he said, "Do you want to write a book?" And I said, "Well, not really. I'm kind of busy doing everything else that I do." "Well, we'll pay you like $2,500." And I said, "Oh, okay. Well, you pay me money? So, okay, that sounds great. So let's do it." And I wrote a book on negotiation. It was my very first book, and I think it was published in around 1990. It was called Negotiate or Negotiating to Win, something like that. It was my very first book. And I said, okay, I've checked that box. I've filled that bucket. I don't need to write any more books anymore. And then there was another book, and then there was another book. And before you knew it, I was working full time as a manager during the day. And then at night and at lunchtime, I would be, you know, working on book projects. So I continued to do that until I was laid off. 15 managers were laid off one day at our place of work. And I was laid off. I said, "Oh, that's okay. I've got this writing thing going. It's going to be okay." So I went ahead and the next day I got a call back from my employer. They said, "Oh, we found 6 months more money. Come on back. We can, you know, you can get back to work." And I said, "No, I think I'm just going to do the writing thing." And so it's been, I don't know, almost 20 years now that I've been a full-time writer. I never went back to that management position.
Well, you really are a full-time writer. I mean, I was looking at some of the titles. Now, some of them you ghostwrite, some of them you're developmental editor. You know, I mentioned a lot of this
Right.
stuff, but I mean, there's a lot of dummies books on here too.
Oh.
And they're
Yeah,
not just one topic, you know what I mean?
I'm the king of the dummies, I guess, is
I
what
love
that
dummies
means.
books, by the way, because they're,
Yeah, well, thank you.
well, you have to have a sense of humor to write dummies books, because they're kind of tongue in cheek a lot, don't you think?
Yeah, exactly. And that's what they originally, when we first wrote the first ones, Managing for Dummies, which sold about 600,000 copies, by the way. And then I think it's in
Wow.
20 different languages, you know, three different Chinese versions and all this different stuff. But yeah, I mean, originally they were very much supposed to be humorous and kind of tongue in cheek and fun to read. And that's the
Right.
key thing, is something that was interesting, not just going to bore you to death. So, and that was carried through. I mean, even the later ones that I did, they kind of dialed back the humor a little bit, but they still wanted to be fun to read and not just boring in the textbook.
Yeah, and but you're going across so many categories. I mean, some people are very laser focused, and you have quite a range, I mean, of the topics. How do
Yeah.
you, and if you say you have this background, of course, but I mean, to know consulting and raising capital and military flight aptitude tests and writing fiction, and you know what I mean? You're all over the place. How do you know all
Yeah.
that?
Well, I learn. That's what's good. You know, the thing I found out from being a writer is that you have to kind of learn the topic to write about it.
Yeah,
So,
right.
and I was fortunate in many cases. So, for example, writing children's books for dummies. I've written one children's book in my life, and it was okay. It didn't sell a super lot of copies. It wasn't like Harry Potter or something like that. It was fun to do. But when I did that book, writing children's books for dummies, I teamed up with a woman who has written more than 100 children's books. So she was the expert, and I was more of the support role for her. And I provided, you know,
Structure.
the dummy's structure and horsepower, I guess. And she provided the actual expertise in children's books, which I didn't have. So, yeah, and that's been sort of I guess, a hallmark of what I've done is I've collaborated with many people. And when I do ghostwriting projects, you know, the person I work with who's the actual author on the book. They're the expert in whatever it may be. And I have to get up to speed really quick on what they do and their expertise, and then be able to write that stuff down.
Well, you know, I see all levels of books. I mean, my house looks like a Barnes and Noble because anybody who's on the show sends me books.
Right, you got a lot of copies of books. Yeah.
Right, but you know, and I see. I think a lot of people want quick to the point books. Some people want the really intense books. You know, I was just listening again to Sapiens, for example, and the amount of research that goes into that book, I just can't even fathom taking the time to write something like that.
Yeah.
Do most people want, when they hire you as a ghostwriter, do they want that level, or do they just want, you know, to kind of get their idea out in a normal, regular
right
book?
I'd say it goes both ways. I'd say generally that most of the books I do are quicker.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, maybe 3 to 6 month process of writing the book and finishing a manuscript.
Mm-hmm.
But there are a couple that have been really in-depth ones where we did have a lot of research, a lot of, original research, and then interviewing a lot of people. I did one book, Leading from the Edge, I think it was called, where I interviewed over 100 members of
from the Edge.
There you go. Thank you for catching me.
Okay.
So lessons. Yeah, that book.
Find it. Uh-huh.
That book. I interviewed more than 100 members of what was called YEO, the Young Entrepreneurs right. Organization.
Uh-huh.
Now it's called EO, the Entrepreneurs
right.
Organization. But I interviewed more than 100 people for that book, and that was like that took me forever. I mean, probably each interview was probably at least an hour.
Mm-hmm.
So 100 hours spread over months,
yeah.
and then actually writing the book from that. So some of those books have been really in depth, but most of them are pretty quick. They want to get it done quickly, get it to publisher or self-publish in some cases as quickly as they can.
Well, it's really hard to get a publisher these days. I mean, unless there's somebody like you that has
yeah.
really demonstrated that they can sell 500,000 page views a month or
right, yeah.
you know, whatever
yeah.
it is.
Yeah.
What advice do you give somebody if they're wanting to be, you know, I mean, is it all platforms still? What is the trick to getting a regular publisher?
Yeah, it has gotten tougher than ever, as you've said. I mean, it's more and more difficult. And I've got clients who are, you know, I had a client who was a president, CEO of a major, probably Fortune 50 company.
Yeah.
He had retired, and we had a really hard time finding him a publisher.
Wow.
And, you know, here's a guy who was one of the top business people in the United States.
And paired up with you.
And paired up with me, which I don't know if that was good or bad, but
good.
I think it was good. But no, I mean, you know, he had a great title. He had a great platform. I mean, he had so much support for his platform, but he had a tough time. We had a real hard time finding him a publisher. So I think there's two things, and these have always been true, but I think probably the proportion has changed. So having a really strong platform, and obviously publishers now are really biased towards social media. So people who have podcasts like you do, people who have a lot of reach on Twitter, Facebook, you know, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of followers in
mm-hmm.
some cases, that makes it so much easier. And then you still have to have a good idea. I mean, I've got publishers, I've been working with clients who've got amazing social media platforms, you know, who have a 5-page marketing plan for their book when it comes out. But the publisher says, well, you know, this book isn't really up our alley. It's not something we would want to typically publish. I mean, you still have to have a good idea. So I think, you know, traditionally it was the big idea was the big thing. It was probably like a 70-30, you know, 70% in favor of a big idea and 30% in favor of your platform. I think that's probably, reversed to some degree. Maybe it's 60% in favor of your platform. But there's still a strong 40% in favor of your idea. You've got to have a good idea. That idea has to be the right idea for that particular publisher.
Yeah.
And it's got to be something they want to publish and will publish.
You know, I've had so many people say that, you know, used to be the publishers did so much for, you know, marketing the book, but now it's almost like not so much, and you're not getting big money up front and all the things. Everything's changed, and you know, I remember, you know, just how it was. I remember having one of my agents in the past, you know, that it was just a whole all it was platform, and that was long before I really
Right.
had this platform. And then I've watched what you're saying go through different changes, and you've obviously got the chops for this, so everybody's going to want to publish your work. But I see so many people who are trying, and I'm curious though, with all these books, and you can't pick your most recent one because of course that's going to be your favorite. But before this one, what was
Right.
your favorite book you've written?
Well, before this one, there's a book called Unlearned. It's one I did with a guy named Barry O'Reilly. I've done a lot of technology books lately. I've been kind of working that area lately. So agile software development, product development, this whole software product area. And this guy, Barry O'Reilly, comes out of that world, the software product development world. And his book is called Unlearn, Let Go of Past Success to Achieve Extraordinary Results. And that was a really good book. It came out maybe a year and a half ago, I think, something like that. And what made it so good was that we really interacted really well. So
That
you
is
know,
fun.
when you're a ghostwriter, when you're behind the scenes, your developmental editor, whatever it may be, you've really got to have this spark, this kind of you know, ability to work with other people, but not just that, but then to also spark, you know, conversations and really deep thinking about a subject. So, you know, we were kicking around ideas, just kind of philosophizing about his ideas in his book, and we just, you know, we just kick them around, and that book, we did that more than any other book I've worked on with anybody else. There was just so much interaction and so much, you know, elevating the ideas. We'd discard an idea, we'd bring in a new idea, we'd kick it around, we'd elevate it, and then it would go into the book. And so that book is my favorite, I think, a lot because of the process that we went through to really create a really good book. I mean, it's a really good book for sure.
Well, I haven't read it. I'm going to, because it ties into what you know, I wrote about in my book about curiosity, because I think a lot of us are holding on to status quo thinking. And so that's on my list. So thank you for that.
Well, great. You bet. Happy to add it. Happy to add some more to your list,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, that's okay. I got time now to read.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah. But your most recent book is Wait, I'm the Boss? So I want to make sure people who are reading this, that is definitely a question mark. Actually, question mark, exclamation point, question mark. What is this book about? And just give us a little bit of idea about it.
Yeah, so this is a book mostly for new managers. So, and this was the case when I became a manager. Again, I was not trained at all. And I think this is pretty common for small businesses. So startups, small businesses, and probably medium-sized businesses, which are the majority of businesses in this country. They don't do any real management training. They don't, you know, have management courses set up. You know, the large businesses, the big Fortune 500s, they do. They have, you know, entire courses and tracks that you go through to become, you know, skilled in management. They teach you that those skills. They have classes. They have, you know, things that you go through as an employee. Once they've decided that you've got that kind of leadership ability or potential. But most businesses, small and medium, don't have that. So I think a lot of people get thrown into management positions that never had any training at all. The only thing that they've seen is their boss, you know, their
Right.
manager. You know, how have they managed and what do they do to be a manager? And you know, the bad news about that is that, you know, Gallup has done surveys and bad bosses are the number one reason why people quit their jobs.
Right.
So you know, there are a lot of bad bosses out there, a lot of bad managers and supervisors. So this book, I created this book really to be a guide for anyone who's been thrown into a management position just out of the blue. All of a sudden, and that's what the question mark, exclamation point are all about,
right.
is that, you know, you've been thrown into this position and you've never been trained in it. So this book has all the basic skills that every new manager needs to do his or her job well.
Well, you know, I remember working for a smaller to medium-sized company where when I became a leader, they did the same. They gave you training on how to fill out your expense reports. They gave
oh,
you
yeah.
a lot
like
of training.
Important things.
But
sure.
nothing, not one tiny thing about leadership. And I'm thinking, wow. And I had that in education industry where we're teaching people to be leaders, and yet none of that is, you know, they don't follow what they had, you know, is what
Right.
they didn't practice what they preached, I should say. And
Yeah.
I've had leaders, like you had mentioned, that emulated their boss, and if their boss was a jerk, they were a jerk. And it's a very tough time. I think you said it's a lot different in the larger companies. And I worked for AstraZeneca for 20 years, and they
Oh,
had just
wow.
incredible training.
Yeah.
I mean, just,
Big time.
right. So to go from that and then to say, yeah, here's your desk and figure it
Right.
out.
Good luck.
Yeah. You're just like, wait a minute. What happened to that 2 year thing that I just did at the last
Right.
company? So
Right.
I think it can be really challenging for a lot of people if you've been in a company and then, you know, you go switch companies, and it's just every company has its unique thing. But I'm curious what you think is probably the most difficult problem, though, that new managers have. Is it that they're not trained, or is there a problem they need to solve? I mean, what's
Well,
the worst part for new managers?
yeah, I think it's making the transition from being an expert in something to becoming a manager. You know, it's a different job. So let's talk about salespeople. You know, salespeople typically they perform if they're high performers, they are eventually tapped to become a sales manager. You know, they might be the best salesperson in the whole company. And that's maybe what they should be doing. Maybe they should just still be doing sales instead of getting pulled, but they inevitably get pulled into sales management because, oh, you can lead a team of salespeople and you can teach them all how to be a great salespeople. You know, being a sales manager is not the same as being a salesperson. And there's so many people who fail, or they just, you know, A, they don't want to, maybe they don't want to be a manager, and they kind of go kicking and screaming the whole way. Or they're not trained to be a manager, so they don't really know how to do it well. There's a variety of different reasons, but I think making that transition from being an expert in something, an expert salesperson, an expert negotiator like I was, an expert whatever it may be, and then becoming a manager, that's a tough transition for many people to make.
Hence a chapter on the Peter principle, I imagine.
Yeah, getting promoted to
Your level
something
of
higher than,
incompetence.
yeah, of your level of confidence. Yes.
Incompetence, yeah.
Yes, and that is indeed the case in many cases. And there's one other aspect of that that's really difficult for people too, I think, is that, you know, when you're on a team, let's stick with salespeople. You're on a team of salespeople, and then you become the sales manager. All of a sudden, you're leading people who were your peers, who were your friends, who used to go out to the bar with after work and hang out with. And all of a sudden, you're supposed to manage them. And, you know, first of all, they're going to say, wait a second, what makes you any different than you were last week when we were all hanging out together at the bar? Why am I supposed to follow you now? And it works the other way too. When you're the manager, all of a sudden being put in that position where the people who were your friends, who were your colleagues, are now your subordinates, quote unquote subordinate. That's a tough position to be put in too for that manager. It's all, you know, you're supposed to monitor their work. You're supposed to check their performance. You're supposed to discipline them if they're not doing what they're supposed to do. That's a difficult transition to make.
It is. It's really challenging. So, well, can you give advice of how to be a better manager? And I thought you had three things that you can offer. Let's see what those are.
Yeah, well, definitely. There are some things you can do to be a better manager. I mean, there's a million things, but let's just focus on a few. And I think, you know, optimism is really a huge thing. I've worked for managers who are very pessimistic,
Oh, that's
and
tough.
you know, they yeah. And if you work for a pessimistic manager, why would you be optimistic? Why would why you know why you know
Culture
what
flows
that
down.
it brings the whole office down. It's like you know, you're in a constant rainy organization. You have this cloud over your head all the time. So anyway, I think, you know, managers need to be optimistic. They need to really bring up the people who they work with. They need to, you know, elevate them, not bring them down. Honesty is another thing that I think is extremely important, and transparency. So when things are going bad, tell your people, you know, don't hide it. I think a lot of managers think that they should hide bad news because they don't want to get people upset. They don't want to get people riled up. I think it's extremely important for managers to be completely transparent and honest, you know, with information as they get it, and to communicate that widely. And also be inspiring. Everybody wants to work for someone who inspires them. I mean, I would much rather work for someone who inspires me and follow someone who inspires me than someone who doesn't. We all want to have a purpose. We all want to have work in an organization that's doing good things and hopefully changing the world for the better. So, if you're a leader who has adopted that, who embraces that, who wants to change the world and has found a company that can do that, then inspire the people who work for you and make sure that they feel that they're a part of changing the world as well.
Well, I can't, I couldn't agree more. I think with me, my biggest pet peeve is lack of respect. When people show a lack of respect to you when you're trying and you're doing your best, and that just the snarky, kind of attitude, that is something I think is problematic for in manager or employee. I'm curious what you think three things that managers should try to avoid. I'll put that on the list if you don't.
Well, definitely avoiding that for sure. I think that whole snarkiness kind of thing is something you should always avoid. But I think a lot of managers fail to delegate, and this is
That's
something that
right.
I had a pro yeah I had a problem with it when I was a manager. I mean, you're a manager, you've got something that needs to get done. You think to yourself, well, should I give this to this employee? I know it would be good for them to learn this, but I know it's going to get done twice as fast and maybe five
Better.
times better if I just do it myself.
Right.
And I think managers fall into this trap of just doing it all themselves because they think it's going to be faster and better that way. And they don't take the time to delegate work. So not only are they overburdening themselves, but they're not developing their employees.
Right.
Their employees need to develop. They need to learn these things. They need to, learn decision making. They need to learn how to stand on their own 2 feet. And what ends up happening is a manager feels like he or she can't leave. You can't go on vacation. Because what's going to happen when I'm gone? I'll be
Right.
gone, even for just a week. Is this place going to fall apart without me being there? If you're afraid that your place is going to fall apart without you being there, you're not delegating properly.
That's so true. And I think it's so hard for so many people at the beginning because they just want it to be perfect, and then they think it's going to look like they haven't done what they should be doing if their people fail or whatever. But you really aren't developing people if you do that.
And you've got to give them the opportunity to fail. I mean, you've got to give them the
Right.
opportunity to excel, but to fail,
Right.
and then learn. Then you can, what they need to learn. What kind of classes they might need, or what kinds of assignments they might need. But you won't know until you test them, until you try it, give it a shot.
Yeah, and I think failure is such an important thing. And when in my research on curiosity, when I wrote not only my book but the assessment I created, I found that there's four things that keep people from being curious. And the acronym is FATE, and the first is F for fear, and then assumptions, the voice in our head, technology, over and under utilization of it, and environment. And so we're talking about some of these things, and I think fear of failure is something that holds so many people back, and that leads to status quo thinking. And right now, we need companies to really be innovative and to do so much more. So I love that you touch on all those things in all the work that you do. And I'm so excited you have another. I know you've written more than 100 books. Is this 101? What number are we on?
I think we're somewhere around 125, but I
Oh.
honestly, I haven't, I just sort of let it go for the last year or so. I haven't recounted,
That's
but
funny.
I should count up, but I think I'm getting close to 125 right about
That's
now.
how I got with my teaching. After I taught my 1,000th business course, I'm thinking, yeah, I'm not counting anymore.
Wow.
I'm over
Exactly.
that.
Once you get
Right.
a thousand, that's huge.
I'm done. You know what I mean? I'm still
Exactly.
teaching, actually. So someday I'll have to go back and figure it out. But
That's amazing.
I can't believe how many books you've written. This is just really, and they're all so amazing. I mean, to get into the dummies and all the things that you've done, I am really impressed by your work. And I hope you can share, like, how can people find more from you if they want to get your books or find out more about you? Do you have a link?
Sure. Well, go to my website, petereconomy.com. And Peter Economy is just like it sounds like, that's for sure. And everything's right there.
What a cool, is that a like name you made up or is that your real name?
I wish I'd made it up, but no, my grandfather, he came over from Greece, I think in 1919 or something. And his last name was Economou, you know, it was Greek. And I think when he, I don't know if it was when he went through Ellis Island or something, I think someone probably said, you know what,
too hard.
Economou, yeah, I don't know. It's not like, why don't you try some an American name like Economy? Okay, will you let me in? Yes, okay, Economy from here on out. So
And
that's where
your
it came from.
future grandchildren will be able to write about business, and it'll be a cool name for them. So there you go.
There you go. That'll be something. I'll look forward to seeing that someday.
Yeah, well, it's been really fun though to to go through all your work before you were on the show. I was like, wow. I mean, I'd heard of a lot of your work, but some of it I hadn't. And I'm like, now I have another one to add to my list with Unlearn. So thank you for sharing that, and thank you for being on the show.
Thank you, Diane. I had a
Yeah,
blast. This
it
is
was
great.
fun. Thank you. And we will be back right after this message. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank both Gino and Peter for being my guests today. If you've missed any past episodes, you can find them all at drdianehamilton.com. If you go to /blog, once you're there, you can actually read them, which is really great because we link everything that we talk about on the site, which is it's just so much easier to sometimes read it. But of course, if you're listening to this on the radio, we're on the radio stations, we're on podcasts, iTunes, iHeart, you name the place, we're probably there. So hope you're able to access us. And if you ever have any questions, you can go to drdianehamilton.com to find out more about my speaking and training. Anything to do with curiosity is there, but it's also at curiositycode.com. So I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.